Hello, I'm Professor Von Schmohawk, and welcome to Why You. In the previous lecture, we introduced the quadratic formula. Given any general form quadratic equation, ax squared plus bx plus c equals zero, the values for the constants a, b, and c are entered into the formula that then produces the solutions to the equation. We also saw that an expression within this formula, b squared minus 4ac, called the discriminant, indicates the type of solutions the quadratic equation has. If the discriminant is positive, the quadratic equation has two distinct real solutions. If the discriminant is zero, the quadratic equation has one real solution. And if the discriminant is negative, the quadratic equation has no real solutions. This is because the quadratic formula includes the square root of the discriminant, and no real number can be the square root of a negative quantity. However, what if there were numbers that could represent the square root of a negative quantity? Then every quadratic equation would have solutions. But what would these solutions look like? Mathematics has a long history of extending our number system to include new types of numbers. For instance, when the only numbers in our number system were the natural numbers consisting of only positive integers, it was not possible to subtract a larger number from a smaller number, or even to subtract a number from itself. However, eventually, the number system was extended to include zero and negative numbers, forming the set of numbers called integers. Any two integers can be added or subtracted, and the result can always be represented by another integer. The set of integers is therefore said to be closed under the operations of addition and subtraction. When negative numbers and zero were first proposed, it was not without controversy. Many mathematicians felt that negative numbers and zero did not correspond to anything in the real world, and it was not even clear how they should be visualized. Eventually, it was decided that by extending the number line to infinity in two directions, both positive and negative numbers could be represented as well as zero. Even if one rejects the idea that negative numbers represent anything real, sequences of addition and subtraction operations can be performed that give a positive result, even though the intermediate results may be negative. For example, let's say we start with 3, then subtract 7, then add 2, then subtract 1, and then add 5. The result is positive 2. However, to produce this result that everyone agreed represented an actual quantity, we traveled through the shady land of negative numbers to get there. Unlike the natural numbers, the set of integers are closed under both addition and subtraction. In fact, they are also closed under multiplication, but they are not closed under the operation of division. Although in some cases, dividing one integer by another produces another integer, in other cases, the result cannot be represented by an integer. However, once our number system was extended to include fractions, the set of rational numbers was created. Our number system was then closed under addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division, as long as the divisor is not zero. But, as the Greeks eventually discovered, there were still certain quantities that could not be represented even by rational numbers. For example, no rational number exists that could represent the square roots of certain numbers, or constants such as pi, the ratio of the circumference of a circle to its diameter. However, when the set of rational numbers was extended to include irrational numbers, the set of real numbers was produced that could also represent these non-rational quantities. But there are still some results for certain mathematical operations that cannot be represented even by real numbers. For instance, no real number can represent the square root of a negative number. Therefore, the square root operation will not work on all numbers if our number system only includes real numbers. This led mathematicians to wonder if it was possible to extend the number system so that operations like the square root could operate on any number and always produce a result. So let's imagine that there is a number that, when squared, produces a negative number. We will call this number I, since it exists only in our imagination and doesn't correspond to any quantity in the real world. Let's define I by saying that I squared is negative 1, and therefore the square root of negative 1 is I. Adding this imaginary number and multiples of this number to our number system allows us to take the square root of any negative number. For example, the square root of negative 4 can be written as the square root of negative 1 times positive 4, which can be separated into the square root of negative 1 times the square root of 4. And since the square root of negative 1 is I, the square root of negative 4 is I times the square root of 4, which is I times 2, or 2i. So even when the discriminant for a quadratic equation is negative, by including I in our number system, solutions for that quadratic equation will still exist. However, those solutions will not be real numbers. So let's see what these solutions might look like. Let's take an example from the previous lecture when we attempted to find solutions for the quadratic equation x squared plus 6x plus 10 equals 0. In that example, the quadratic formula gave the result x equals negative 6 plus or minus the square root of negative 4 over 2. Since no real number equals the square root of negative 4, we concluded that no real solution exists for this quadratic equation. However, if we allow imaginary numbers in our number system, then as we have just shown, the square root of negative 4 is 2i, and the quadratic formula then gives the result negative 6 plus or minus 2i over 2. Separating this into two individual fractions and simplifying, we see that the solutions to this quadratic equation are negative 3 plus or minus I. Or writing the plus and minus cases separately, the two solutions are x equals negative 3 plus I and x equals negative 3 minus I. Each of these solutions contains a real part and an imaginary part. So how can we represent these values of x graphically? Real values can be represented as a point on the number line. But I is fundamentally different from any real number, and every point on the number line is already assigned to a real number. We need some way of representing I that doesn't involve allocating a position on the real number line. In 1799, mathematician and cartographer Caspar Wessel suggested that I be represented as a position on an imaginary number line oriented perpendicular to the real number line. The number I would be represented as a point on that vertical line, 1 unit distance above the origin. The number 2i would then be a point 2 times that distance, or 2 units above the origin, and so on. Likewise, negative imaginary values would be represented as points below the origin. Since I can be multiplied by any real quantity, the imaginary number line would contain an infinite number of points representing an infinite number of imaginary numbers, in the same way that the real number line represents an infinite number of real numbers. If we consider these two perpendicular number lines as two axes that define a plane, then any point on that plane could represent a pair of real and imaginary numbers in the same way that any point on the xy plane represents a pair of x and y values. These sums of real and imaginary values are referred to as complex numbers, and the infinite set of complex numbers is represented by the infinite collection of all the points on this complex plane. A complex number is written as a plus bi, where a is the real part and bi is the imaginary part. For example, the two solutions to the quadratic equation that we just saw, negative 3 plus I and negative 3 minus I, are complex numbers, each consisting of a real part and an imaginary part. These solutions would therefore be graphically represented as two points on the complex plane. Their real parts are both negative 3. And their imaginary parts are I and negative I. It is important to remember that although the complex plane looks similar to the xy plane, there is an important difference. The xy plane typically represents a relation between two one-dimensional sets of numbers represented by the values of the variables x and y. For example, if x represents the input value of a function, and y represents the output value resulting from that input, then this relation can be represented by the ordered pair x, y that corresponds to a point on the xy plane. By plotting all points like this, we can produce a graph of the function. On the other hand, a point on the complex plane represents a single complex number, and that number is a member of the two-dimensional number set represented by the complex plane. So we have seen that complex solutions to quadratic equations are represented graphically as points on the complex plane. But how can we make sure that these solutions are correct? We should be able to check these solutions by substituting these values of x back into the original equation, x squared plus 6x plus 10 equals 0, to see if they produce a true statement. For instance, if we replace x with the value negative 3 plus I and perform the arithmetic, we should get the true statement 0 equals 0. But before we can do that, we have to know how to perform operations like addition and multiplication on complex numbers. In the next lecture, we will see how this is done.